Yeah. We don't do that.
And I've been rocking my brain. What was in it? Because I always have to.
Because if I don't, he won't go out.
I know, and then you don't know what's going on.
I gotta get. Now I gotta get another
car. Can't run a big chicken turn.
Oh, my dog.
It doesn't go anywhere.
Good morning, First Christian Church.
Toasted.
Welcome this morning.
Did a really fun.
We're gonna go ahead and begin our song service. If you'd like to stand,
we welcome you. I still don't know what's that makes sense.
Aren't you supposed to be down here to a collection night? Aren't you supposed to be down here to a collection night?
I want to be where it's cooler.
Oh, really? I'm down there.
I don't need rain.
No.
It's a draft
down here.
Church, how's everyone doing? Don't all respond at once, because I wouldn't be able to understand anyway, so. welcome to my favorite Sunday of the month. Anytime we get to eat after church is always wonderful to me, so we get to do that 2 weeks in a row, just so we know. So A lot of things are starting back up. Wednesday Night Live started back up with our bowling, but then we're back to regular session this Wednesday. Our Thursday night Bible study starts back up this week, so plan on attending that, 6:30 here at the church. We have Family Sunday this month. If you know anybody that you can invite to church, we come together and worship as a church family. You don't necessarily need a family, it's a church family. And all the kids will be down here again. They'll kind of showcase some of the things that they do. And I'll have a one-off kind of message for us. And that way we'll it maybe be a little more exciting. So also, we have our annual meeting coming up as well next Sunday. So next Sunday is going to be a big Sunday, okay? And I need everyone's help next Sunday as well. So if you have anything planned next Sunday, cancel it, right? No, I'm just kidding. But if you could, if you could stay next Sunday and help, I know is it before the annual meeting or after the annual meeting? Before the annual meeting, we're going to have to do a youth group fundraiser, junior, senior high youth fundraiser, spaghetti dinner here at the church to help raise funds for the things that we do with them. And then we'll have the annual meeting, and then at 2 o'clock, we're going to tear this place apart, okay? Because the sanctuary is being painted on that Monday. The project is going to start Monday the 17th. And so we need help taking handrails down, taking those speakers down. And whether you know it or not, there's a bunch of stuff behind these walls that you can't see, okay, that have to come out and go somewhere else. And so we need your help. We got to pull the organ away from the wall, different things like that. So we got to move those pews back there in that cry room there, stack chairs up, pull that pew out, all kinds of stuff. Okay? There's a lot to do. Just so we can get this place ready to be painted as well. So if you can help with that, that would be highly appreciated from me and from the elders and anybody who has investment in this church. It would be great. We're trying to kind of make it a little bit updated as far as colors go, and a little bit of subtlety changes. Hopefully you'll like it. If not, I'm sorry, and that's what God has led us to. So, and so we're going to do that, but there's just little things, like all that stuff coming up the wall down there, all that stuff has to be taken off the wall, different things like that. So just could really need some help. Just many hands make light work. So that's going to be next Sunday at 2 o'clock. We're going to shoot for 2 o'clock. Hopefully it'll be after the annual meeting's over. But we're shooting for 2 o'clock. If you didn't want to stick around for the annual meeting, you can leave, go get something to eat, and come back. That'd be awesome. So that's happening. Other than that, I don't think I have anything. Is there anything I missed? I know Sister Ed has a meeting today, correct? Okay. You ladies will get your food and then come upstairs, I think. So, but anyway, I think. Oh yeah, junior senior youth group starts back up tonight. We're excited about that. Jen and Tolan and a few others have been working really hard on the youth room, so hopefully it's getting up there. And I know we got a brand new TV and a new video game console thingy, like arcade game. It's really cool. I like it. So you can find me playing it throughout the week now. So before I pray, Terry's got to take care of some annual meeting stuff, and then. I'll let him do that.
This is just a list that we have to read a couple times prior to our annual meeting. Recommended officers for 2022. Recording Secretary Tammy Havrilla. Assistant Chris Honrud. General Fund Treasurer Tanya Allen. Terry Allen Assistant. Mission Fund Treasurer Carly Bayou. Youth Fund Treasurer Jen Allen. Roxy Allen Assistant. Bible School Superintendent Rita Sheely, Jen Allen Assistant, Building Fund Treasurer Mary Hamford and Tanya Allen Assistant, and then our Financial Secretaries Ron Bailey, Mary Hamford, Tammy Havrilla, Diane Jones, Ron Robinson, and Sue Robinson, and then our Elder that's up for voter confidence this year is Bill Sheely, and our Trustee that's up this year is Buzz Robinson.
Ron Robinson is Buzz, so if nobody knows that. So I didn't know that for how many years was it, Buzz? Like two years, I think it was. It's like, who's Ron? Me?
Oh, okay.
So, all right, let's pray, and then I'll hand it back over. God, I just come to you to thank you so much for this day, and thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be together as family. Lord, we pray that as we worship with all that we are, that Lord, that you would just be in our midst and just help fill us up for the week to come. And Lord, as we start some activities back up, Lord, this week, that you would just fill this place up. And Lord, help us to live for you in all that we do. And Lord, we just thank you so much for loving us, and thank you for Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.
Please stand and join us.
There's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. Thank you.
On the backs of your bulletins is our prayer and praise, and it's that time in our service where we want to know how we can be praying for you guys and be praising with you. So, how is that? Diane.
We need to be praying for Bryce Baumgartner again. He's going through some pretty hard times right now. So.
Bryce Baumgartner is going through some hard times right now. Okay. Be lifting up Bryce in your prayers. Anything else? Yes.
A couple of updates. My friend Amanda has been on our prayer list for a really long time. She had her first brain surgery last year. She's got another one scheduled in February, but the fainting spells have been getting a lot worse. It's now a daily thing, which is really scary. And then her husband's having surgery on the 12th of January for Ingrid's ankle. And she said, this year is just starting off running, and we're just trying to be faithful and know that God's got it taken care of. But just prayers for their family. There's a lot going on, and they both just had COVID, both just got over COVID, and it's just been really scary for them. So prayers for them. And then my dad is going to go see an oncologist the last week of January. He's in a lot more pain again, and they're going to do a bone scan and an MRI because they're kind of thinking maybe the cancer is spread. So prayers for him and my mom, and they're kind of getting depressed about it. So prayer for things to be okay.
So we're praying for the McDonald family. Amanda's got an upcoming surgery, and her husband's having surgery on his ankle. And then Jen's mom and dad for Jonathan, as he's going to go see an oncologist, and for Brenda for peace for her. So, any others? Yes, ma'am.
I don't know his last name. Charles Robert. He's the one that fixed the food up for the bomb shelter.
Yep.
He slipped on the ice yesterday and mangled his leg. They got to rebuild his ankle, and then he spiral broke the bone in his leg. So he had surgery this morning, so we want to have a prayer and hope that he comes out of it okay, all good.
Be praying for Robert. We don't know his last name, but he slipped on the ice yesterday. He's the gentleman who picks up the food for the bomb shelter, and he fell and broke his leg. So be praying for him. He's having surgery this morning, so Deb said. Anything else? Lois?
Update on my son. He missed his heart doctor appointment because he didn't remember it, and has another one coming up 2 weeks from now. And he is heading back to work.
Oh, that's good.
And by the end of the month, he should be back to work at Salem Hospital. So
that's good. Okay, so her son Patrick is headed back to work, which is great. So
it's been a long haul for that family.
Yeah. Well, we've been praying for the family, so I mean, God's working, right? So that's good. Keep praying for the Poteet family down there, Lois's family. So, anything else?
One more.
Yes, Deb.
You.
Yeah, I got.
I know you're on here, but we just a reminder that
it's pretty close.
Yeah, for two, and you're getting to.
Yep. I appreciate that.
The due date, and they're gonna hopefully fix you up and you take what you can.
Yes, I hope so too.
So.
Thank you, Deb.
Get all cool people to pray for you, but we all.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Yeah.
Deanna, my mom, she just wanted to thank this church for all the prayers and the concerns on her behalf. She is getting around pretty good and starting to take a few steps without a walker already. We're not even a month into this.
That's good.
She's doing well. Just wanted the church to know that.
Terry's mom, Deanna, wanted the church to know that she's doing well and thankful for all the prayers. Anything else? Okay, join me in praying. Lord God, Heavenly Father, just come to you to thank you so much again for this day and this opportunity to be together as family, Lord, as we worship. Lord, I pray, Lord, I know there might be some unspoken ones that seems fairly light today, Lord, but there's things that just plague us all the time that maybe we can't think of or we don't want to say. And so, Lord, I just ask that you would be with those ones that concern us, that we think about family members and friends. And, Lord, I just pray that you would just be with those people. Lord, as the holidays have ended and and we kind of transitioned into a new year, Lord. We prayed for those people that are lonely at the holidays that don't really have anybody. And Lord, it's still lonely, even though we're a month out from the holidays. Lord, I just ask you to continue to be with those people. Lord, be with those ones that don't necessarily have any family members to celebrate with or to visit them or whatever it is, Lord. I pray that you would help us, the church, to fill in the gap wherever it might be. If we see a need, that, Father, we might fill in that gap. Lord, I know that there's things happening in people's lives all the time, hard times. And Lord, especially whatever's going on in Bryce's life, Lord, we don't know, but he's experiencing a hard time. So we want to lift him up to you, Lord, and just ask that you'd be with him and comfort him and put people in his life that are going to speak into his life and encourage him and build him up, Lord. And Father, I just ask that you'd be with the McDonald family. They've had a rough start to this year. Whether it was a new year or not, Lord, it's still a rough patch that they're going through. And so I just ask that you'd be with them, be with Amanda and her husband, as Amanda is going to have a surgery here pretty soon, or her husband's having a surgery here soon, Lord. Lord, I pray whatever is going on in Amanda's brain that you might figure it out, Lord, that you might lead the doctors to it. Whatever, Lord, we want her to be well. And Father, if that's through divine intervention, I ask that you would do that as long as it's according to your will. Father, work through her life. Use her as an example of how to point people to you through all this stuff. Lord, I ask that you'd be with Jonathan as he's experiencing some pain and with his cancer. And Lord, I hate hearing things like that. So I know, Lord, that you'll work, Lord, and I pray that you'd be in him and, again, help his body to be strong and to get through this rough patch again, Lord. And we pray for Brenda as well as she has to go through it all with him. And so, Lord, give her patience and peace as she does. Father, I pray for Robert as he's having surgery this morning. What a terrible accident that was. And so we ask that you would be with him and just help heal him quickly. Lord, we're thankful to hear about Patrick and that he's headed back to work. And we're thankful that you've worked in that family and pray that you'd continue to work and help get them going in the right direction. And last, Lord, we ask that you would just continue to be with Deanna as she continues to heal. We are so thankful that you've worked in her this far and that you would continue to work in her. Lord, we know that you are the great physician and the divine healer, and so we ask that you would continue to heal those. Lord, and as my upcoming surgery is upon me, a little over a week away, I ask that you would prepare my body and prepare the doctors and nurses for what they're going to do, and help me to have a speedy recovery as well, and help me to heal and get back to a pain-free hip, which would be nice, Lord. Lord, I thank you for leading me to the right doctor and just getting me to this point to where it's time. And so, Father, thank you that you've sustained me this far. And Lord, I ask that you would just help all of us as we move in the right direction to grow in you. And Lord, that we most importantly, we would live for you in all that we do, and that we preach the word wherever we go. And Lord, we just want to say thank you for Jesus, for your embodiment of us, you know, to come down to us and rescue us. So thank you. Lord, without Jesus, there's nothing. So I thank you for that. Thank you for coming and being like us and showing us and not letting death hold you, but Lord, you defeated death and you resurrected to show us a way back to you. Thank you for loving us so much that you sent your Son to die for our sins and to resurrect to a new life. Thank you, Lord. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So as we get ready to prepare our hearts for communion time this morning, we're going to be singing a song entitled, What a Beautiful Name. And as we prepare this morning, the words, the lyrics are very powerful. Please pay attention to the lyrics as you sing them this morning as we prepare for communion time.
Hidden gold. Thank you.
communion scripture this morning is taken from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 17, verse 14. Hear me, O Lord, and I will be healed. I'd like to share a communion meditation this morning entitled More Than Medicine by Nancy Karpansky. One little typing error. Instead of communion meditation, if you hit one wrong key, you type communion medication. Medication, a substance used to treat, to heal, or cure a disease. Meditation, a process used to focus one's thoughts on a particular idea. Communion is a time where we stop to meditate, to focus our thoughts. The communion emblems, the bread and the juice, are not medicines. Consuming them doesn't heal you. They do, however, have a therapeutic effect. Touching and tasting the bread and the juice provide a visible reminder to refocus our minds and hearts past the emblems to what they represent, the body and blood of Jesus, our great physician, our healer, our Savior. We are all contaminated. We are all infected with sin. The prognosis would be terminal, no cure. But 1 Peter 2:24 says, Jesus bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that by his wounds we have been healed. The act that caused Jesus such terrible suffering is the same act that saves us from our terminal condition. In dictionaries, the word remedy is followed immediately by remember. Communion is a time designed by God himself, so we who were once desperately ill with the sickness of sin can remember that the remedy for our sin problem is already prescribed for us. We don't need to search for just the right medicine. We don't need to experiment to see what will get results. The great physician has chosen the best treatment available. The price is very high. Insurance companies would never agree to cover it, but no need to worry. The doctor has donated his services. Heal me, O Lord, and I will be healed. Jeremiah 17:14. As you receive the emblems, remember the remedy for your sin sickness. Look into the face of your doctor and thank him for his personal investment in your cure. Shall we have a word of prayer this morning? Lord, we thank you for the sacrifice that was made for us. Lord, we thank you that you came to this, sent your Son to this earth. We thank him that he came and lived among us as an example, knowing full well how it would end, that it would be through his death that we might have a chance of having that sin, that disease that would kill us, taken from us. Lord, we thank you for this chance that we have to come together and to commune with you, a chance when we partake of these emblems, the fruit of the vine which represents the blood that Jesus shed on the cross, and the loaf which represents his body that hung on that cross. And as we partake of these emblems, help us not to see them as just emblems, but help us to see past that to what it represents, that Jesus was willing to come to this earth, give himself up totally, so that our sins might be forgiven. Help us also to remember that this gift to us is given to us if we accept him as Lord and Savior, that we have to acknowledge who he was and accept that sacrifice that he made on our behalf in order for us to receive it. Lord, we thank you so much for your great love for us. We'll never completely understand the total love that you had for us until we are in heaven with you. But Lord, we just thank you at this time for loving us enough to die for us, to take the sins and the punishment that we deserve to have away from us through your sacrifice. So as we partake today, help us to remember you and thank you for everything you have done for us. We ask these things this morning in Jesus' name.
steps are getting harder and harder to walk up. Oh, good morning again.
Morning.
So as we start, we're in the book of Philippians. We're looking at Philippians chapter 1, verses 12 through 18. And we're looking at what the gospel message can do and the powerful message that it is. And so as you're turning there, I'll begin. A long time ago, the only survivor of a shipwreck washed up on a small uninhabited island. He cried out to God to save him. And every day he scanned the horizon for help, but none came. Exhausted, he eventually managed to build a rough hut and put his few possessions in it. But then one day, after hunting food, he arrived home to find his little hut in flames. The smoke rolling up to the sky, he couldn't believe it. After everything that had already happened, he'd lost all that he had left. He was now stung with grief. Early the next day, however, he noticed a ship on the horizon that was clearly coming to the island. The ship arrived and the crew came off the ship and rescued him. "How did you know I was here?" he asked the crew. They replied, "We were passing by and we saw your smoke signal." You see, when his hut burned to the ground, devouring everything that he had left, he thought that all hope was lost. But in the end, his hut burning down became his salvation. Though he didn't realize in the moment, his hut burning down was actually a blessing in disguise. So I ask you, have we ever felt like this before? Have we ever felt like nothing was going our way? Or like everything in our life was working against us? Just to discover that God was working through those bad experiences and those awful circumstances in order to bring us into something greater in our life. If you have, you'll be able to relate really well with what Paul was dealing with. What he was experiencing, what he was going through as he was writing this letter to the Philippians. You see, in this series here, we looked last week at the opening part of the letter that Paul is giving thanks to God for these people, for this church that has been doing wonderful things and incredible acts of faith. And he wanted them to know what a blessing they were to him, and he prayed for them often. But he prayed that they would continue to grow and to learn and mature in their faith. That it wouldn't just be this little isolated event. Now we come to the place where Paul is wanting them to know for sure that he is okay. He says, "Look, I'm doing okay. I'm in chains. I'm under house arrest. I'm literally chained to another human being." We'll get to that in a minute, and I'll explain that in a little bit. See, Paul understood what it was to be stuck. Paul understood that feeling of the rock in the hard place. Because he wanted to be out preaching the good news and spreading the love of Jesus. He had all these plans. He talked about these plans that he had, these other missionary journeys that he had. But he's being held back from doing it. And he didn't really like it all that much. Because he feels like he was called to the highest calling in his life, and that was to preach Jesus to the nations. But he was stuck in prison. His frustration must have been out of this world. Because he wants to go out and preach about Jesus, but all he can do is write letters because he's stuck in a room somewhere chained to some human being. A Roman guard. But we'll see in Scripture today that even though he was held back physically in his ministry, God used this moment to spread the gospel even faster than if he could have been on his own and out of chains. Because we have to understand that there's nothing that can stop the gospel. There is no adversity in this world that will stop the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. It cannot be held back. Let me pray and then we'll dive into Scripture. God, I just come to you to thank you again for this day and thank you for the opportunity, Lord, to be here. Father, as we look at this letter to the Philippian church, I pray that you would just speak to our hearts and our minds to what you would tell us. And Lord, let us sometimes move our own self out of the way as the gospel advances. And as we look at what it is, may you speak to our hearts and our minds this day. Lord, use me as an instrument to communicate your word. May they hear you and not me. It's in Jesus' precious holy name I pray. Amen. If you're in your Bibles, it's Philippians chapter 1, verses 12 through 18. He says, "Now I want you to know, brothers," some of your Bibles, if you have a newer Bible, say "my brothers and sisters." just understand it was a cultural thing, okay? It is speaking to the whole church, okay? Ladies included, okay? Now, I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has actually served to advance the gospel. As a result, it has become clear throughout the whole palace guard and to everyone else that I am in chains for Christ. And because of my chains, most of the brothers have become confident in the Lord and dare all the more to proclaim the gospel without fear. It is true that some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry, but others out of goodwill. The latter do so out of love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel. The former preach Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, supposing that they can stir up trouble for me while I'm in chains. But what does it matter? If you have a pencil or a pen, underline those five words. But what does it matter? The important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached. And because of this, I rejoice. Yes, and I will continue to rejoice. So Paul begins here with a letter, this letter to the church, you know, thanking them again. It's pretty clear from his prayers that he's very close to this church, okay? By now, they've almost surely aware that he's in prison. They've probably sent people to where he's at, and they probably come back and reported it, so they probably know. And a lot of times when we know someone's in prison that might be wrongly in prison, we are concerned for them as well. And so they were worried about Paul. They might have been hearing rumors how he was treated in prison or whatever, this jail that he was being held in or the house arrest that he was in. And they really didn't like it, okay? But what we can see from this very first verse 12 is that they are concerned for his well-being. And what Paul tells them that he's okay, all right? And actually, everything is working out for the best. Look at that. I want you to know, he wants them to know, that what has happened to me has actually served to advance the gospel. And because of it, it's become clear throughout this whole place that I'm in chains for Christ. He's saying even though he's in prison, despite his obstructions to his ministry and the potential death sentence that he faces, it's actually serving as a powerful witness for Christ. The gospel is advancing even though he's under house arrest. And because he's arrested, did you see, catch what he said? This whole place knows why I'm here. Can you now stop for a second and ask yourselves, if you were one of those Roman guards and you found out that he was here just for talking about someone, a guy named Jesus, as a Roman guard, you might begin to ask yourselves questions like, man, he didn't do anything wrong, right? So tell me again what you did to get here chained to me. You talking about a guy named Jesus who did what? And he got to preach the gospel to them, okay? The triumph of the gospel is happening under this arrest, okay? This whole place knows about Jesus. They know he hasn't broken any laws, okay? They know that he doesn't even deserve to be there. They know that he's suffering for the cause of this good news, the gospel. And guess what it's doing? It's changing lives. Because everyone wants to know why he's there. Tell me again why you're here. Every time someone asks, what do you think Paul was doing? Oh, I'm just here. No, he's telling them about Jesus, right? Everyone wants to know how offensive this is and maybe this exciting thing about Jesus. If people are getting thrown in prison about it, well, it's probably pretty exciting. You're locking up somebody for talking about Jesus, huh? And they want to know why. So this work of the gospel is benefiting. It benefits not as a free man, but it's benefiting him under house arrest. And he's recognizing that God is working through this misfortune. Paul is smart enough that he's going, look, this stinks, but God is working, man. Okay? And no matter what happens to him personally, what matters to him most as a Christian is that people are hearing about Jesus. That it is growing and spreading. But did you see that it's not just affecting the people in prison, the place that he's at? Did you catch that? He says that most of the brothers have become confident in the Lord and dare all the more to proclaim the gospel without fear. Okay, this is huge. Because Paul's in prison, people were like, hey, you can't throw our guy in prison. I'm going to tell people about Jesus. Let's see if we're all of us in prison, right? Okay? And so they began to speak more confidently about Jesus and tell people about Jesus everywhere they went. It's advancing in prison. It's advancing as the church is at large. And it's exciting and it's becoming, and it's helping them to be more bold. They're doing things that they normally wouldn't do. They used to be quiet and timid and let Paul do all the work, right? But because he's in prison and they're seeing his example lived out, his attitude about it, not only his attitude, but his fortitude to push through it, the power of the gospel is spreading uncontrollably. And here's the thing that I come to. If chains and bars, if prison can't stop the gospel, then what do we have to fear? You see, the Romans thought that they could shut the advancement of the gospel down by throwing their main guy in prison. But what did it do? It lit it on fire, right? And so these people in this church are like, you can't do that. I'm going to tell people about Jesus. Maybe they knew somebody else that got thrown in prison for speaking about Jesus, and it caused them to grow more. See, this fortitude is important for us to understand. The fortitude is the pushing through the hard stuff, okay? Having the fortitude to push forward. You gotta understand, he's facing a death sentence, okay? He's chained to a person who gives him no privacy. There's other people there. There's not a moment to himself. But all the while, he's ministering to the churches through messages and letters. He's ministering to those around him in the prison, both the guards and the attendants that come. And on top of that, people are hearing about what he's doing. And so they're pushing forward more to advance the gospel. And nothing seems to be able to stop the gospel from spreading at this point. It's an exciting time to be a part of this church. And this is why people were encouraged. Because not only were they seeing Paul, what Paul was doing, they were seeing what their brothers and sisters were doing, and it caused them to see the raw power of the Holy Spirit at work in this area. Man, it was moving and growing, and people were stepping up. But we got to understand, it's not all sunshines and rainbows, okay? Living as a Christian is not always easy. It's choosing to do what God has wants us to do versus what the world wants us to do, okay? And sometimes, thankfully, it doesn't land us in prison for preaching about Jesus, okay? But it did for Paul. And there's other people that are taking advantage of the situation. Did you see that in verse 15? It is true that some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry, but others out of goodwill. The latter do so out of love, knowing that I am put here in the defense of the gospel. The former preach Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, supposing that they can stir up trouble for me while I'm here in prison. Okay? And I'll tell you, not everybody was a fan of Paul's work. They didn't really like his popularity. They didn't like how he was rising and telling people about Jesus all the time. To us, we look at Paul and He was somebody who was ordained by Jesus to go on a mission to tell people about Jesus, to go and make disciples, right? But back then, there's a lot of people out there preaching this message, preaching about God. And they saw what Paul was accomplishing with Jesus. And so there might have been some that were doing it for rather than being followers, true followers, they were profiteers, okay? It was a competition to make money. They thought Paul had a scheme, so they took his message of Jesus and they spread it to make money. His same message, they would take it, and they're like, man, people will follow us. They'll give us money, right? Okay? We still have that this day and age, just so we're clear, okay? Also, there's just people that don't like Paul. They don't like where he came from. They don't like that he was Saul of Tarsus, who actually persecuted the church. And we see that actually much of the content in the letters that Paul wrote was actually refuting false or misinformation about Jesus. from these people, from these teachers, okay? But not all of them were false teachers. I want you to understand that. Because Paul would point them out. He'd be like, look, those guys are fools, okay? But he does it here. He actually says it's okay. They're teaching the doctrine that was fine, but they're doing it with the wrong intentions, okay? They're doing it to make money, but they're preaching Jesus. They do it maybe out of jealousy, or they're just upset, maybe competition, and they say, you know what? I'm just going to take advantage of the situation while Paul's in prison, and I'm gonna grow my brand, right? Okay? They figured since Paul was in prison, they would take advantage of this. And there was tons of people coming out of the woodwork, apparently. We don't know who these people were. I want you to understand that. We don't know who they are. We don't really know where they came from. But they were clearly people who were jealous of the influence that he had at first, in the first century, okay? And we assume here that they're not false teachers, okay? Because when you read the scripture, Paul doesn't say, don't listen to those fools, right? But he says something that is highly unusual. See, the thing about it was, even though they were preaching out of selfish ambition or jealousy or vain conceit or things like that, they were still preaching the gospel of Christ. He says, I don't like what they're doing, but not their teaching. Okay? And these Christians who did not like Paul and wanted to remain in prison for their benefit, okay, he says that it doesn't matter, okay? What does it matter? But what does it matter? He says the other people that are preaching out of love with good intentions. And these people are who Paul believes are ambassadors for Christ, okay? Even though he's wrongly imprisoned, they're still preaching Christ and we're getting the message out. They're picking up the mantle where he can't. Maybe they're going out to the village churches. You know, they're going out and preaching. Paul is stuck in prison. Man, how frustrating would that be? But people, because of it, are being saved. They're hearing the gospel. People are preaching the gospel with good intentions to help him. But again, there's people out there trying to discredit him to boost their own position. And I can't even imagine how frustrating this might have been for Paul. He just had to let it happen, right? But then that's what he says. That's what he comes to the conclusion of. Remember? I told you to underline this. But what does it matter? This is actually the literal translation from the Greek. What does it matter? He says the important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached. Okay? What does it matter whether people are preaching the gospel from good or bad intentions, with good or bad morals? As Paul is assessing the division in the Christian community at large, we find him happy about it, rejoicing. And because of this, I rejoice. Because regardless of the reasons that they're preaching Jesus, Jesus is being preached. The gospel is advancing. It's moving, and things are growing and exploding. He ended up in prison. He's got plans, but God is using his imprisonment to spread the gospel where he's at. People are taking advantage of him for their personal gain, but the gospel is spreading. No matter how much Paul disliked their motives, the gospel was spreading. Yes, he was grieved by their division. He didn't really like their motives, but he got to celebrate through that division and through their bad motives because the gospel was being spread. And folks, that's what it's about. It's about the gospel being spread. Paul was locked up for Jesus, for preaching about Jesus, and his opponents wanted to tear him down, but they were still preaching the gospel. So we need to understand this. First, the gospel is more powerful than what we have planned. I don't know how many of you have ever made plans and thought, well, I'm going to do this or I'm going to do that. And I'm going to go here and I'm going to go there and I'm going to accomplish all of this. Before I met Jesus, I had all these plans in the world. I was going to be this and I was going to be that. But I also will tell you that there was a sense of hopelessness in my life. Like, why am I here? What is the purpose of this? Then I met Jesus, and all of that changed. All of that changed for me, because the power of the gospel is more powerful than my plans. God took a hopeless teenager and transformed him into something for him. Yeah, have I made plans? Yeah. I still think it's good to make plans. But don't let it damper you when those plans change. Don't let it get you down. It's like, oh, why wouldn't God let me do this? Understand, God has something better for you. If your plans don't work out, God has something better for you. You just might find yourself in jail. And if that's not going to throw a wrench in your plans, I don't know what will. Just like Paul. But despite our circumstances, you know what? We can live for Jesus in prison, can't we? Maybe you were falsely thrown in prison. I don't know what it comes down to. But that doesn't matter. It's not the place. It's not the location. It's not where you are at. It is whether you're living for Jesus in everything that you do. Are you letting Jesus shine through you? Are we making plans around God? Are we allowing God to work through us? Yeah, we might see how God has those inconveniences for us, and some people let it tear them down and just, you know what, God's always against me. I've always seen it as a God is redirecting me rather than God is against me. Because Scripture tells me that if I'm for God, God is for me. Just because God puts a roadblock or a turn in my plans doesn't mean he's against me. Maybe the curve's out ahead or something. I don't know. Or the bridge is out. I'd fall to my doom, you know? I'm talking about life, not actual bridges. Okay, hang with me there. I saw some of you like, what is he talking about, bridges and roads? Okay, life bridges, okay? So we got to ask ourselves, how might God use the inconveniences and roadblocks in our life now to work his plan in the world around us? How might God work in the times when everything doesn't go according to our plan? And here's the big one for me that I ask myself. Am I open and willing to allow him to work through me when everything I've worked for falls apart? Okay? That's a big one for me. And I know that's a big one for a lot of Christians that we struggle with when my plans fall apart. It's like, God, why wouldn't you let me have that? Are we open and willing to allow God to work through us when everything we have worked for falls apart? These are questions only you can answer. I can't answer them for you, okay? Second thing, the gospel is more powerful than what we struggle with. And I'll tell you what, that's good news, okay? Because if we let our struggles dictate who we were, we wouldn't be a very good person. If Paul let prison dictate who he was and how he told people about Jesus, nobody would have known about Jesus, because he would have been depressed because he was chained to another human being. See, house arrest didn't look like it did 2,000 years ago. I said I explained this a little bit. They didn't have ankle bracelets when you got sent on house arrest, okay, to track your location. What they did do, they chained you to another human being. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, you slept next to them, you were chained to them. It wasn't an ankle bracelet, it was an actual chain. He had no moment to himself, no privacy. During his entire time under house arrest, there was always someone chained to him. When he was eating, sleeping, using the bathroom, writing letters and praying all the time. And if you're anything like me, man, that would have sucked. Not for a moment to yourself, not a moment to relax, to think and reflect. And that sounds like one of the worst things to me, is to be chained to somebody 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. That literally, I love my family, but I do get annoyed by them sometimes. I'm like, I gotta go for a walk, okay? I love them with all of my heart. But I've told you before that my ideal place is alone in the woods, okay? And to be chained to someone else would be torture for me. No moment is truly ever his own, He's constantly watched. He's constantly jerked around. If the Roman guard wanted to go somewhere, he goes with him. Not only that, but he knew people were in the world out there actively destroying what he has tried to accomplish. Paul knew what it was like to struggle. If house arrest wasn't enough, it was the people around him that were out there trying to tear him down. The gospel advanced, even though these struggles happened. Even though he was under house arrest, even though people were actively trying to hurt him and tear his ministry down, the gospel was spreading. The gospel is more powerful than the struggles you and I face in this life. So some questions I have for you. How might God use our struggles to work his will? I know in my life, any time that I've struggled and God has allowed me to persevere through it, guess what? I have a new notch in my testimony belt, you could call it. It's not a prize of mine, but it's something that I allow God to use me for. That when struggles happen and I have those hard struggles in my life, I try to allow God to work through me. And when I come out on the other side and I go, hey, friend, I know you're struggling with this too. God brought me through it and he can bring you through it too, and share with them. Also, question, how might God work through our pain, our grief, and our anger to advance the gospel in the world around us? To share his good news with those in our surrounding areas. We all have it. We all have that pain, that grief, the anger, the struggles. We do. How might God work through that? I'll tell you, I have a sign in my office that reads, "The best sermons are lived and not preached." And I believe with all my heart. Non-Christians will see how we react to the world and its struggles. And they'll either come to the conclusion that Jesus is worth it or not. Do we waller in our struggles and pity me and woe to myself, or do we allow God to work through us? The gospel is more powerful than your struggles. And we need to understand that. Third, the gospel is more powerful than our failings. And again, that's good news as well, because we all fail. Yes, we all have those issues and struggles, but we also have those things where we fall flat on our face. That we'll never be Christ-like in this life. We can get so close, but we'll never be Christ-like until we're with him. You have to remember that we're running a race, not a marathon, folks. And the goal is to be as Christ-like as possible, but we will fail. All sin and fall short of the glory of God. The sad truth is, though, that sometimes we all get affected by those things that those people who are trying to tear Paul down were. We get jealous. We get angry. We sometimes have poor motives. We sometimes get bitter. And why is that? It's because we're human. We're not God. We're not Christ-like yet. We're striving to be all the more Christ-like and striving every day. But we have to recognize our failings. We have to recognize that through humility that we are essentially not going to be our own God. We have the same emotions as everyone do. We have pride. We have the idea that we want to be on top. We want to be recognized. We want to be loved. And sometimes when we have those moments where we feel like we're up here and somebody doesn't come along and stroke our ego, we feel like, who are you? I'm not being recognized for my work, my dedication, my love. You haven't accepted me. And we have all those emotions that come reeling in and we act out sometimes. We do, because we fail. God, the gospel works through our failings, folks. Whether it's through poor motives, whether through it's all those things, the gospel will still advance if we're trying to live for Christ. Even through those struggles, even through those failings. The gospel is more powerful than our failings. And it's more powerful than anything that we are. The question we ask ourselves is, how might God use our imperfections or our failings to complete his perfect work in the world around us? How might God work through that? Do we go back and ask for forgiveness when we make a mistake? I'm really sorry I got angry at you for something as stupid as you being better at this job than me. Do we ask for forgiveness? True forgiveness. I don't know what it is. Again, I don't know what it looks like in your life. As we close out today, I want you to remember, if you remember anything from today, this is what I want you to remember. The good news of Jesus, the gospel, is more powerful than any and all adversity. Anything that we face in this life, nothing can stop it. Remember, Paul was in prison. He was preached against. People were having more courage to preach the gospel. The gospel was spreading. Nothing was stopping it. Because Paul recognized that God works through all of this. That it wasn't just his little niche where the gospel was advancing. It wasn't just his little bit that says, hey man, I'm the man. He understood that God was working through everything. And we have to be mindful of our calling to share the good news of Jesus. We need to be open to God's ability to work through our plans. We need to be open to God's ability to work through our grief. And we need to, through our pain and our struggles, we need to be open to God's ability to work through our imperfections. Because there are people that are hurt and lost and dying without Jesus every day. We cannot let our personal circumstances dictate how we live for Jesus. We have to live for Jesus in everything that we do. And what does it matter if someone else is preaching the gospel over there? Or what does it matter if someone is doing that over there? My hope and prayer for all of us is that we would be open and ready for God to use whatever the circumstance, just as we are, failings and all, wherever life takes us. That's what I pray for our church and for me and for you. Understand, we don't need to be perfect for God to use us. God doesn't say, fix everything in your life before you come to me. He says, come to me and I'll fix everything. Just be willing to accept God using you as you are to further the gospel where you're at. And I love that verse. It's one of my life verses, actually. But what does it matter? What does it matter? Pray with me. God, I just come to you to thank you again for this day and thank you for the advancement of the gospel, Lord, in Philippi. Lord, I know it wasn't just Philippi that was the gospel was advancing, Lord. I know it was everywhere. It was in Corinth. It was in Thessalonica. It was in Ephesus. It went all the way to Rome, Lord. All over the known world, the gospel spread. Lord, you use us. You want to use us to advance that gospel. Lord, I pray that we would come to a realization that we don't have to be perfect. Lord, that you want to use us where we're at, failings and all. But Lord, our hearts need to be yours. And so, Lord, I pray that if there's someone in this room that hasn't surrendered their heart fully to you, that they would. And Lord, that you would use whatever messed up part of their life they have. If it's messed up, if it's going pretty good, Lord, thank you. But Lord, use us where we are at, no matter what. Lord, help us to live for you wherever we go. Help us to preach the word wherever we go. And Lord, what does it matter if they preach the gospel over there? If they're getting the recognition for preaching the gospel, what does it matter? Lord, all I ask is that the gospel would advance through us, through our circumstances, wherever we're at. Thank you for Paul and his struggles. Thank you that we can read about him and know that he made it through them. And Lord, that he still loved you through all of it. Thank you for loving us. And thank you for Jesus. His name we pray. Amen. Our music team is going to come forward as we close out. and maybe you're on the fence about Jesus, the only thing I can tell you is that Jesus is worth it. I know back when I was 15 years old, I had a hole that I couldn't fill with anything. And I didn't know why until I heard about Jesus. Until someone preached the gospel to me. And I heard it and I knew what it was. If nothing else, Jesus gives us hope in a hopeless world. Jesus gives us hope of eternity in a hopeless world that is lost and dying. And if you're on the fence about Jesus and you don't know for sure, and you want to talk to somebody about that relationship with Jesus, I'm here. Rick, Terry, or Bill are here. Your friend that brought you is here. Maybe they don't know everything. Maybe you bring them to me. Maybe your friend brings you to me. Whatever it is, if you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior, what are you waiting for? Let's stand and let's sing. And if you want to talk about it, come talk to me. Your communion cups, if you don't mind pulling them out of the pews and out of the little holders things and try to throw them in a trash can if you would, that would be great. It would just help us out around here. And sometimes the janitor misses them because you can't see them. Maybe you stuff them in the seat or something. It would help us out around here. Also, don't forget, if you want to stay for potluck, we have plenty of food. Obviously, you can smell it. It smells wonderful. Come join us. Even if you didn't bring anything, I'm sure there's plenty of food. So come and enjoy a time of fellowship with us. But other than that, go and live for Jesus. Preach the gospel wherever you go, not just with your words, with your life. Pray with me. God, I just come to you to thank you so much for this day. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be together as family, to worship you together as we are, as a church. And Lord, I just pray that you just fill us up with your Spirit and help us to preach the gospel wherever we go. Because we want to see the power of the gospel move people's lives. Lord, help us to live for you in all that we do. Lord, as we go into our time of fellowship, of our potluck, Lord, I just pray that you'd be with our time. Bless this food to the nourishment of our body. Lord, I love all the hands that prepare it, and it smells so good. So thank you for that. Lord, just be with us and just help it to bless our bodies, to the nourishment of our bodies, and thank you for the hands that have provided it. Lord, we love you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Go and love God and love others, church. Have a great day.
Again.